excited about you as a church family and the way that you're growing and building yourselves and prospering in every ministry and in vocation and building yourselves. And we gather here once a year to put special emphasis on this most important relationship. Other than your relationship with God, this will be your most important relationship. And the way that we construct relational dynamics, you stand at the center, you and that spouse are just the next circle, and then on out with family and with vocation and with church. But I believe this relationship that we're working with and talking about this evening and tomorrow morning is the strength and the heart of the church, because this is what launches our children. And our children and this relationship, this familial construct, it makes the church. And so we're really excited about working on these things tonight and tomorrow morning. And then Sunday is Family Sunday. So we'll just turn Brother Mills loose to deal with whatever issues or concepts that he wants to deal with. But I always enjoy this this weekend. We're very excited about it. And the first thing we want to do is invite the presence of God. So why don't we just praise him for a little bit, worship him, talk in tongues, and invite the presence of God. He inhabits the praises of his people. Let's invite his presence. God, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. We lift you. We magnify you, Lord God. Take your husband or wife by the hand and continue to praise. Continue to worship. Talk in tongues together there. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Some of these, I have to tell you, I have not read. I read reviews, but I have not read. So I would love some feedback on these, because I may be a minute or two getting around to these. So if you would take a look at them and tell me if it's a dog, let me know. And I'll replace it with something good. But I didn't buy any titles that I usually give out and that we have given out through the years. So these are all relatively new. One of you has in your possession a book that says, yes, your marriage can be saved. I only got one of those. So I don't know. But I figured if it can save your marriage, it ought to have good information about how to keep your marriage in good shape and not having to be saved. Anyway, so that was something else. But it eludes me. So we will... We'll turn Brother Mills loose here, and just recently, oh, by the way, he was just telling me about Brene Brown and a brand new book that she has. Do any of you have that one yet? Okay, so we're looking forward to that. Brother Mills, before they left Atlanta today, they attended a live presentation from her. So they are excited about that book and about that material, but so are we. Darren Gravely piece was just wonderful for us, and we've given out a box or two of those. So, Brother Mills, we're excited about you being here. We want you to come and take your liberty. Why don't you welcome him as he comes? Sister Mills, we're so glad that you live here.
Praise the Lord, everybody. That was kind of puny. Praise the Lord, everybody. All right, that works. So I am excited to be here with all of you tonight. I am a marriage and family therapist, so I actually do this during the week too, and I love the work that I do. Love working with couples, love the job I get to do, and I'm excited to be here. I'm excited that my wife got to come with me. This is an unusual thing for us to be out of town together. It's even more unusual that our kids, so we may not go home. They can drive now. They have a card that they just text us and say send money to, so they're pretty much just afloat, I think. But glad she's here with me. You'll be hearing from her tomorrow. We'll be doing one of the sessions together tomorrow morning when we talk. Thank you, Pastor Sutton, for having us. It's an honor to be here with all of you. Marriages need work at every state along the way. That is the one thing that I've found to be cool and neat about my work. My oldest client that came in to see how he could be a better husband was 74 years old, I think, and had been married over 50 years, and he had just retired 2 or 3 years earlier, and he wanted to be a better husband. And so I thought that was really neat. And then I'm working with a couple right now. They've been married 2 years, and at their 2-year anniversary mark, they went away. And they sat down and they made a list of everything that they saw at the 2-year mark they thought could become potential problems in the future for their marriage. And they have come in because they want to work on those things before they become actual problems in their marriage. So, and then I work with some people where it's just like a nuclear bomb went off and I'm trying to duct tape it together. So I see the full spectrum of things, and I'm glad all of you are here, because you want to be here, and we're going to have a good time this weekend. Right? How many of you are scared I'm going to call on you and ask you something? Nobody? Okay, one person admitted to being scared. So everyone else is open. It's just a wide open season here. Actually, the first thing I'm going to talk about tonight is I think before we can be healthy couples. Oh, I do want to tell a funny story I just heard about a couple. They were 92, and they came in and told their therapist that they wanted to get a divorce, and they needed him to help them to divorce well. And he said, at 92, why do you want a divorce? And they said, well, we had to wait until the kids passed. just kidding. I think, before we move on, that I need to make my introductory statement about if you have some questions that you would, specific questions that come up that you would like answers for, if you want to write those down and just kind of drop them off over there where I'm sitting, I will do my best to address all those. A lot of times we have some of the same questions for multiple people, and so just write them down and I'll kind of assimilate them, and we'll do our best to answer those along the way. Or if you want to ask anything, feel free to ask as we go. How many of you have what you would say is the ideal family? The absolute, your family of origin, your marriage now, everything's just perfect. Okay, we have a couple of really smart men. I saw two men raise their hands. How many of everything's always good? Your kids do what they're supposed to do. The house is always clean. The cars are always washed. There's always money in the bank. Does anybody have that life? Because a lot of times that's what we get, especially if you're on any form of social media, because that's what it looks like everyone else has that life. Because we only take pictures of really pretty food in really nice restaurants. Nobody takes a picture of eating Wendy's in the car. And so we get this idea that we're the only people that can't do these things. And the truth is that for most people, life is really not just this huge, great adventure where everything's perfect. The first thing I'm going to do, I'll just tell you in advance, and then I'm going to move on into it, is I'm going to talk about who we are, because I don't think we can have good, strong marriages if we don't have a good idea of who we are as individuals and where we fit. And I think we have to understand fit before we understand anything else. I can't be a good husband if I don't like myself. And if I don't bring the best me into the marriage that I can bring, then it gets messy pretty quickly. And if I need my wife to fix all of my errors, that gets difficult really, really quickly. And so it's really important that I understand who I am and kind of the reality of what goes on. So I am a marriage and family therapist. I'm also home stretch. The end is in sight of finishing up a PhD. If I will just write my dissertation, if you're a very mean person, please see me. I would like to hire you to make me write my dissertation. I need someone to stand over me and threaten me at this point. So in doing that, I've always been a nerd, and I'm kind of an information junkie that I know a lot of pointless information about a lot of different topics. I've been to the Coca-Cola Museum like 17 times. That's a literal number that I've been there. And I would go more, but my wife won't go with me anymore. She has put up boundaries for this. But what the data, so I do a lot of research, love research. What the data tells us about family is that coupledom, familyhood, still remains today, as of current research, 2017, for most adults, the commitment that stretches and enriches the most, drains and renews them the most. So it is truly both of those things. And one thing you'll hear me mention probably a good bit this weekend is living in a both and world rather than an either or. Typically, life is going to be a lot of both and. And it's seldom going to be either or. The best example that happened was a few weeks ago. I was teaching at church, and I was really just hot that night. And I'm not a profuse sweater, but I was sweating, and you could see that I was hot. It was visible that I was hot. And so I was just really uncomfortably warm. And then sitting about 20 feet from me were two sweet little ladies in their 80s wrapped in blankets. And I was actually talking about kind of both and living that night. And so it was just this perfect God-given example of I'm sweating. They're wrapped in blankets. We're in the same room, the same environment. It's the same temperature on the thermostat. Which of us was wrong? And it really sums up life of what I'm talking about with both and. There's going to be some times that the most enriching and renewing and life-giving thing you have is your marriage and your family. And there are going to be some days that the toughest thing and the most draining thing and the biggest stretch that you have is your marriage and your family. And it can be both of those things. And it can come in seasons. And it's not going to have to be an either or. Just because it's bad now doesn't mean it has to be bad a month from now. Just because it's really, really good right now and you hit a rough patch later doesn't mean that things are horribly off course and we can't correct. It's going to be a both and. It's going to enrich. It's going to renew. It's going to stretch us. And it's going to be both of those things. And so where do we look to find what we need to know about the family? Does anybody want to guess where we look? The Bible. How many of you have heard that the Bible is the best book for a family and a marriage? Have y'all heard that? Okay, quick experiment right here. Somebody tell me one family in the Bible that is not dysfunctional. Think through it real quickly and give me a non-dysfunctional family. Here's the truth. There are not any. Old Testament or New Testament. Every family you look at, they range from really messed up to kind of messed up. Timothy's about as good as it gets, and his dad didn't go to church. But he had a good mom and grandma. And so beyond that, it's pretty sloppy. You have Adam and Eve. That didn't work out too well for any of us. And then we have Abraham, which was in reality the first blended family. Children from two different sets of parents. Two moms involved there at the beginning. And we're still, if you bought gas today, you're still dealing at the pump with the mess that made. Because his kids are still fighting. And then we have David. Wow, is all I can say when I look at David from a family systemic point of view. His kids try to kill him. He hides in a cave. He has affairs. He murders people. It's a complex story. And then we have Samson, raised in the church, backslid, ran around with worldly women. And so it gets pretty messy pretty quickly, and we hear over and over and over, look at the Bible, look at the Bible, look at the Bible. And you know what? I think my family did. I'm pretty sure, and my wife agrees. Like, I can tell by the look on her face. My family looked at the Bible, and they just kind of took the best of all of it and said, let's do it all. Let's just do Genesis to Revelation. And so it gets a little bit uncomfortable. And so there's some uncomfortable truths about who we are that I just want to address, because I think if we can situate where we belong and get our identity straight, then we can really move forward with this firm foundation for what our marriages are going to look like. Scripture does not outline the steps we need to take to ensure a better family life. The Bible is truly not a manual in a manualized sense of 10 steps for a better marriage. It's not that kind of book. It's important. Family is. The Bible is definitely important. Family is important. But it's not our first identity. Now, I'm not talking about priorities. Pastor Sutton talked about priorities, the way we prioritize ourselves, our marriages, church, vocation, where all those things fit. That's priorities. I'm talking about identity, who we are. Our primary identity is that we're part of a body that is itself the bride of Christ. So my identity, single or married, it doesn't matter where anyone falls on the spectrum, my primary identity is that I am part of the body of Christ. And it's essential that we understand our identity cannot be wrapped up in our spouse. I love my wife and I love my children and they love me. But at some point, I've got to be able to stand on my own two feet. And my wife has to be able to stand on her own two feet. And my kids have to be able to stand on their feet. And we have to know who we are. Because if I can't, do they compliment me and make life richer and better and look better and nicer? Yes. But absent of that, I am still part of a body. My identity is in Christ. And I've got to have that foundation. And I'm going to talk about that a little more. Paul writes of how that Christians, they suffer with others who suffer and rejoice with others that rejoice. So when we look at this from the family perspective, that's what it means to understand as couples, as individuals that we're part of the body of Christ, because we're never in this alone. So when your marriage is struggling, if you understand that you're part of the body can help you heal. My hand is not independent of my body. If my hand gets cut, blood's going to come from all different places. There's going to be all different things happen because my whole body needs my hand to get better. And when we understand that we are part of a body, it takes away the isolation of troublesome times. And it brings us into a place where there can be healing. And so that identity is important. And the family provides us with the earliest opportunity. So you as a couple, you as husband, when I talk about family, I'm not just talking in the context of kids and all that. I'm talking about the two of you. You're a family. It provides us with the earliest opportunities to experience interconnectedness that's found in our relationship to others because of a more fundamental relationship that we share together in Christ. So it's not just me that's part of the body. We're both part of the body. And that together makes that stronger. And so it's important that we get this interconnectedness. A true scriptural viewpoint of family recognizes the importance of mutuality, in which family members have obligations to one another that are made important because of the covenant made in relationship to God. I am a good husband, hopefully, because I am part of the body of Christ and because God calls me to be a good husband. And so I get to experience that. That's part of my relationship with him, is having a good relationship with her. And so getting that identity piece down, it's not just that I come to church and worship God and I have this life, you know, I have this church life and I'm in church and I go to church and I'm a member of church. That is part of it, but this is worship also. Because the way I love her and the interconnectedness we have, that's part of my identity and part as part of the body of Christ. Does that make sense? And so if we can learn that when we're in good relationship with each other, that is in itself, it's part of being part of the body. This is part of worship. This is part of church. This is part of being apostolic, is to be a good spouse and to be a good husband, a good wife. These things are important. The second truth, if you haven't figured this out yet, I'm just going to tell you, marriage is tough. Has anyone, you don't have to raise your hands, you can just like widen your eyes, figured it out that marriage can be tough sometimes? So far, two people have admitted that marriage can be tough. So marriage can be tough sometimes. It's so important to realize that it's tough because we live in a fallen world and it's comprised of fallen people. And so I came into the marriage with a little bit of baggage. And my wife didn't bring as much baggage into the marriage, but she brought some. Is that right? Is that fair? And so, y'all don't have to be nervous. She's heard all this, so like we're not going to get off on the wrong foot here. But we bring brokenness into it, and it gets complicated. It gets complicated quickly. So I'm from a family, my mother's deceased. My parents were married until she passed away. My mother-in-law and father-in-law, they were married before they got in church. Then they married each other. Then they got in church. So my father-in-law has two children. My mother-in-law has a child. Then my wife is the youngest of the four, and they're 10, 13, 16 years older than her. And so we get into this whole deal of like, we have 12 different Christmases we have to organize around. And that's just a reality. And it's tough, and she's the only one that belongs to them together. So if everybody else is there here to go to the other parent's home, guess who's supposed to be there on Christmas? She is. And then we've got my family, and my dad got remarried, and she had two sons, and we have to, then all of a sudden, like, figure out, are we going to do Christmas together? Like, we're all grown. This is weird. I just was happy that I survived and remained the baby. Everybody was still older than me. That was all I was concerned. I told my dad, if you get remarried, no toupees, no convertibles, no women who are still young enough to have children. I am the baby. And so I got to keep that. But it's complicated. And it's difficult. We're going to talk some tomorrow about just, it gets kind of messy sometimes when you think, oh, this is the way we do marriage, and this is the way we do coupledom. And then the wife or the husband comes into the marriage and it's like, no, this is the way we do coupledom. I've never heard of anyone having mashed potatoes at Christmas dinner. You just don't do that where I'm from. We have certain things you have. My in-laws do it completely wrong. They don't have any of the right foods for Christmas. This was a problem. My dad worked in offshore drilling. He was gone 14 days, home 14 days. We kind of had a 14-day window on either side of anything. So you might get your birthday gift before your birthday, on your birthday, after your birthday. Just no way of knowing. That worked great until her first birthday when I thought, well, I work today, but I'm off tomorrow. I'll just get it then. I mean, I was only one day late. It gets messy sometimes. And that's just a truth. Your marriage is not the only one that's difficult. And I'm not saying that snarkily. I'm saying that, like, we're all in this together. Everybody's had some tough moments in marriage. And that you're not broken, and you're not deficient, and do we all have room for improvement? Yes. But you're not unique in the sense that you have some rough patches. We all do. The third thing, when you are married to and you have children, all these things, the person you're married to, your children, all these things, that's not your first family. And that hits us really sideways because we're told that family first. And again, priority-wise, that's one thing. Identity-wise, we're talking about something else here. As good and as important as families are, it's an important thing to realize that it's been most lost on most of us today, is that the people of God and the body of Christ are scripturally considered our first family. And what I can tell you is this: the family is not God's most important institution on earth, because it is not the social agent that most significantly shapes and forms the characters of apostolics. And it is not the primary vehicle of grace and salvation to a world. The church is. The church is what shares the gospel. And the church is what shapes characters. How many of you can say that you're exponentially a better human because you've got the Holy Ghost and you're a part of the church? The church is what shapes that character and forms that character. The church, us, me, you, all of us, we're who tell other people. Did somebody invite you to church? Did somebody bring you to church? Did somebody teach you a Bible study? Somebody did that. That person was part of the church. The church is the most important family in God's eyes. I'm going to tell you how powerful this is. We have a young boy. His mom left him and his brother when they were little. And our church just kind of we've essentially raised these boys in church, and then mom got involved, so now we've got one of them still there. He's 15. Mom has not been on the scene since he was about 6, 7, somewhere in there. Dad is from West Africa, has a totally different culture of parenting. Dad's only been in the U.S. Not much longer than the boys are of age. And so Dad is a totally different way of parenting. Great provider, not a lot of connection, not a lot of presence there. Just kind of lets the boys raise themselves. Mom doesn't go to church. Mom creates a lot of havoc and upheaval, kind of floating in and out of lives and everything. We need a bass player in our church right now, and he's 15. He just took all of his money that he saved up and went and bought a bass, and he's taking bass lessons. Mom didn't teach that. Dad didn't teach that. A good marriage didn't teach that. The church shaped that. He walks to our house. He goes to high school right across the street. Our daughter either picks him up or he walks over pretty much every Tuesday night before church because he wants to be there. His older brother works and is frequently not able to be there on Tuesday or doesn't get there in time, but he wants to be at church because he wants to be able to learn to play the drums too. And so he walks across the road and hangs out at our house every Tuesday night so he can go to church and be there. Nobody's making him go to church. We're not talking about healthy family functioning here. We're talking about a healthy church body. We're talking about people that come together and realize I'm part of something that shapes other people. And if we can learn to let the church work on us, and if we as part of the church can work on other people, and if we can let, if our marriage is tough and having some rough patches, if we can let the church work on us a little bit, because that's the body that's going to help us the most, we are part of what God chooses to make everything happen, the church. And that is so counterintuitive. When we start reading books and we start looking at things and we start listening, we just hear, oh, the family's the most important institution. The family's the most important institution. No, the church is the most important institution. And the church is what shapes us. And so, as uncomfortable as it is, I'm not talking about priorities. You've got to keep your marriage a priority or it's going to be a catastrophe. And if we start having a lot of catastrophic things in marriages, we'll have catastrophe within the church. And so we got to keep marriage healthy because we got to keep the church healthy. We got to keep the church healthy because that's God's primary family. We're part of who he's getting married to. He wants us to be in good shape because we're his wife. So we're talking about the same kind of relationship. That's why it's important to realize I got to stay healthy in the church. Where am I here? So, did I say there were 4 uncomfortable truths? I meant there were 3. So, in the end, biological family, it's important, it's necessary, but it's part of the most important thing. So, that is the intro. You got to understand who you are. Who's your first family? Okay, we're going to practice that. Who's your first family? Okay, a little bit more robustly. Who's the first family? Good job. Gold star. Church is first family. Is marriage always easy? Is it tough sometimes? Does that make you normal? Everybody, I want you to say that again. Does having tough patches in your marriage make you normal?
Yes.
Is it stretching and draining sometimes?
Yes.
Is it awesome and rewarding a lot of the time?
Yes.
Good job speaking up loud right there. It's all of those things. And so knowing who we are and knowing what we're a part of is incredibly important. And so now that I've kind of framed where we're a part of, we're going to remember the primary thing here. There's no perfect family in Scripture. And there's a strong indication when you look at families that the overwhelming evidence in Scripture is that the importance of families is found in their function, not their structure. So it's what those people did once they all got together. It's what they did. It's how they functioned, not their structure. And so with that in mind, how we operate is so much more important than what we look like. I'm going to tell you, and my wife can amen this, she could probably do a whole 5-day workshop on it by herself. My family, my personal family of origin, looks good in church. We can do church, but we're a mess. We're like a really, really big mess. But we did church great. I sat on the fourth row my whole life. The Family Life Center, I'm not kidding, is named after my mother. And I'm going to tell you, it's a mess. Not the Family Life Center, my family. And so there's just something to really, really be stressed here that it's really important that you function better than what you look like. If you're struggling, please get help. Because we're part of the church, and the church needs to function well to be able to shape characters and change lives and deliver the gospel. And so if you are having a problem, get some help. And that's what we're doing this weekend, is getting help and strengthening some things. And so how can we be the strongest families we can be then becomes what really becomes important here. So if our function, how we function, matters more than what we are structured and what we look like, then we really need to be our best. And so for the rest of our time together, we're going to focus on a couple of key components here to building some really, really strong marriages. Tomorrow, we're going to do, the first session is going to be, probably just one session, is going to focus on expectations. So that's going to come tomorrow. Expectations, to me, is probably one of the most definitive thing that couples need to know. You need to know what your husband or wife is expecting. Like, I need to know what my wife expects out of me. She kept telling me early in the marriage, like, we need family time, we need family time, we need family time. Well, where I come from, family time wasn't happy. So I wasn't really excited about having family time. And I said, what do you mean by family time? And she's like, you know, family time. And I'm like, no, I don't. What do you mean? Like, you need to give me something measurable. And she's like, okay, well, I like think that it would be, I want you to like sit on one of the couches in the living room for 20 to 30 minutes a night, just so when the kids are coming through, they see that you're actually there. And then I want us to have 3 or 4 meals during the week where it's just the four of us and you don't invite anybody else. Because I love people, and like to me this looks like a really fun time. Like, let's just eat and talk. And I can do this like every meal, pretty much. My wife's a little more introverted. And then we have 2 kids, and so we needed to carve that out. And then that we would go do something as a family unit of 4 at times where we just went and did things. I could work with that. I still don't think I sit on the couch very much, do I? Well, I know I don't. I don't even mean to ask. So I'm failing at point one. I think I do pretty good about having the meals. They're just not at typical times. A lot of times our dinner's at 9:30 or 10. But we do. And we've built our some rituals. I traveled a good bit a number of years ago doing work, accounting work, and we had this deal that when I would fly in, it didn't matter what time I would get home, her and the girls would meet me at Steak and Shake. And so, is that typical? No. But is it kind of one of those fun family traditions that our kids had when we were little? Yeah, it is. It's a neat thing that we met at Steak and Shake. And so, learning what we expect, what we expect, we can then do that. And culture teaches us differently about this, because culture says, the modern culture that we live in, teaches us that I should just be able to look at her and just kind of go, and her know, oh, he wants a roast and mashed potatoes and gravy. That's what we think is like that. And then we get really, really angry because I'm blinking three times and tilting my head to the right and the laundry is still not getting done. Is this right? And it gets really, really a lot easier when we learn to say, hey, this is the way, I don't know how you did it at your house, this is what we did at our house, what are we going to do here with the two of us? And we're going to talk about that tomorrow and how we have those conversations. And then tonight, I'm going to mention probably one of the most dreaded words that couples hear, and that's communication. All the men just did an inward groan. I can hear it. In defense of men, I will say stereotypically, not always, stereotypically, about 85% of the time, men are not the best communicator in a couple. We were on our way here today, and my wife said, what? I don't know what she said. She was like, we're going to be late. I said, well, it doesn't start till 8. She said, well, I didn't know that. I said, well, you didn't ask. And to me, that made perfect sense. If she wanted to know the specific time, she would have said, what time? Not when does it start. When does it start means it starts on Friday. What time does it start? It's a totally different question. And so communication, I'm not a good communicator. And here's the deal is, just know this, men, put this in the back of your head. Communication does not necessarily mean talking more. My wife told me once that we were married 10 years before she realized that I talked a lot and never said much of anything. She said it's sweet, though. Or at least in hindsight, it feels sweet. It doesn't mean talking more. It means being meaningful and intentional about what we say. And then in defense of our good sisters is communication can't happen without us talking. So in defense of whichever, if you're one of the 15% of males that really gets into verbal communication, or if you're the 85% of females that gets into verbal communication, I'm going to tell the non-communicator, you have to engage in this. Okay, you can't think about it. You can't want to do it. You got to do it. You got to have tough conversations. You got to learn to talk about it. And we're going to talk about some of those things. There's, according to the research, there's a key factor that's been identified for healthy, happy marriages. And it's really, really easy. This is so simple. And we're not to the communication part and how to do that yet. But I'm going to tell you a really, really easy thing. Do you know what the number one indicator for a strong marriage is? It's not communication, actually. It's not intimacy. It's friendship. It is friendship. How much do you like each other? That's the key indicator to a good marriage, is are you friends? Do you have... If I got you to tell me your story, this is one of the things that I always do when a couple comes in for counseling. I'll say, tell me how you met. And I can typically get a feeling, regardless of the problem that they come in with, I can typically get a feeling about how things are going to kind of shape up over the long haul. If I get like a, we get to talking and it gets a little bit more relaxed and they start telling it and there's a kind of good vibe about how they met versus, well, he ran into me. And if there's a lot of kind of just, about how they met, it's like, well, I asked you out on a Thursday. No, you didn't. It was a Friday. And we went and had steak. No, we didn't. I ordered chicken. This is the problem. And everything that I had chicken. If I start getting those kind of stories, I know, okay, we're gonna be here a minute or two. Being friends is so important. Just the mutual respect and enjoyment of each other's company. Just enjoying each other. One thing that we can say, it's not been a perfect almost 21 years, but we've had fun. We laugh a lot. We laugh today on the way over here. We enjoy each other's company. We can tell the same stories about the time when we were newlyweds and my mom and dad had come to visit and I liked a particular brand of tuna fish that you could only get in Louisiana. And so they brought me a big brown paper bag filled with tuna fish. I'm going to tell you, a lot of cans of tuna fish will fit in the brown paper bag. And then a couple weeks later, my mother-in-law and father-in-law came and she had found like all of these pot roasts that were about to go out of, like they were about to expire. So she bought them all and froze them and brought them in an ice chest to us. And then we went through like this 8-week span of time or something like that where when we did our finances at the end of each week, this is the honest to goodness truth, for like 2 solid months, every week when all the bills were paid, we had $11 left over. You can't do a lot with $11. But I'm going to tell you something. The two of us can flat tell you how to make anything with tuna fish or pot roast. Because we ate it for 8 solid weeks. I can tell you that if you grind up a pot roast in a blender and try to make like a tuna salad except with pot roast, it's disgusting. And so we have those stories. Were those fun times? Not particularly, but we look back and we laugh and we enjoy them. There's just an enjoyment with being with each other. Friendship, it really means it's being well-versed in each other's likes, dislikes, personality quirks, hopes, and dreams. I'm going to say those things again, and I want you to write those down. It's knowing your spouse's likes, their dislikes, their personality quirks, their hopes for the future, and their dreams. Now, I'm not going to call on any volunteers because we're here to have a happy retreat. But I do wonder how many of you know those 5 things about your spouse. Do you know what your spouse likes and what they dislike? At a simple level, my wife does not like fruit. I don't offer her a peach or an apple. I know this. I don't like vegetables. She doesn't ever offer me a salad. That's important to know. You know what that means? It means that she remembers something about me. And I remember something about her. We know, generally, our hopes and dreams for the future. I think we've got a pretty good handle on that. You're kind of giving me that look that, no, we don't really. So we'll get back with that in the morning. Personality quirks. I can tell you, she has none. I have much. See, I'm smart. No, I know we know each other's personality quirks. She knows, don't startle me. I will hit you. I'm not a fighter, okay? I'm completely not a fighter. Someone told me in the first grade that they were going to beat me up, and I said, you will hear from my attorney. Okay, I carried a briefcase to kindergarten. I have a picture to prove it. I'm a nerd way back. But if you jump out and scare me, I'm scrawny, but I can scrap with you. And you're going to wish you hadn't. We were on staff with Pastor Tim Copeland for 10 years. And our first year there, we were in a really sketchy part of town in a really scary building that creaked and popped. And I was vacuuming in the basement. And he thought it would be funny to sneak in and jump out. And he was my pastor. And he missed my fist connecting with him because he's really, really fast in jumping back. You can't scare me. She knows that. So she doesn't scare me. I know that you can't spring things on her. I need to give her some advance warning of things. I don't do a real good job of that all the time, but I do better. We know these things. It's important that you know these things. It's important that you know stuff about your spouse. I'm going to tell you one of the worst mistakes I ever made is about 7 days before our wedding, I looked at her and I went, you have brown eyes. It didn't go over well. We still got married, obviously. But you need to know these things. And so to get even, for years I would say, what size shoe do I wear? What size shirt do I wear? Because she thinks it's complicated because we have all these numbers, like 15 and a half, 32, 34, 32, 32. Like, we have a bunch of numbers involved. And so I can always trip her up if she's got on this whole, you don't know my eye color thing. It's like, well, you don't know what size shirt I wear. So, know these things. So there are four roadblocks we're going to talk about that will kill good communication. And if you're participating in these, we need to figure out how we can back out of this. How long have we been going here? Tell you what, before we get into those, stand up, stretch, turn around, eat some chocolate. If you want a cup of coffee, get those. Then we're going to go through these four things tonight. So there is this couple. Their names are John and Julie Gottman, G-O-T-T-M-A-N, and they're the marriage gurus. He's a hardcore researcher. He has, it's called a marriage lab, and like literally couples can go in and they like put oxygen sensors on their fingers and all these skull caps on with brain sensors and everything, and they like monitor couples interacting, and he's got all this stuff down, and his research is really, really incredible. John and Julie's stuff, Julie is a therapist, and she's amazing, couples therapist, and their work on communication is just second to none, and they've identified these four things being present in your communication are some of the biggest indicators to having a very, very dysfunctional relationship, or a relationship that's more likely to not succeed over the long term. So high predictors of a marriage not being successful come when these four things exist. The first is criticism. The big, big thing to know about criticism is that criticism is completely different than complaints. A complaint is, I'm really angry that you didn't take out the trash. That's a complaint. A criticism is, why can't you ever remember anything? I've told you 1,000 times to take out the trash and you never do it. That's a criticism. Same issue. One's a complaint, one's a criticism. Complaint, I'm going to reiterate this again. I'm really upset, hurt, angry, frustrated that you didn't do the laundry, cook dinner, buy me flowers, get me a birthday gift, remember our anniversary. That is radically different than it's what I expected. You never remember my birthday. When we start getting into the all or nothings of ever, always, never, we're getting into a place where we're backing our spouse into a corner where you really can't get out of that. A complaint is about specific behavior. Criticism is about a person's character. A complaint is about, I don't like this behavior existing in our marriage. I don't like this behavior that you are doing or not doing. Criticism is, I don't like you. I don't like you when you take out the trash. I don't like you when you don't take out the trash. I don't like you when you buy me flowers. I don't like you when you do buy me flowers. I saw a couple this morning. Truly, this is on display in their marriage more than anything else. She bought him shoes. True story right here. She bought him shoes. He liked the shoes a lot. He said, I love these shoes. These are like date night shoes. Meaning, these are special occasion shoes. Kind of just why he chose that phrase, I don't know, but that's what he said. So, one day last week, he's getting dressed. He works in an accounting firm. He puts on those shoes. He comes home from work in the shoes that she bought him, that he highly complimented. She says, so, who'd you wear the shoes to impress? They are your date shoes, after all. And so we talked about what a horrible womanizer he was, all because he wore a pair of shoes that he liked. That's about, that, when we get to that, and I can give you, with this couple in particular, like all I feel like I'm doing right now at this stage of therapy with them is managing criticisms. It's just about, there's nothing either of them can do to please the other person, and the fundamental deal is they don't like each other. And so they're never going to be able to do anything that will solve the problem. How can we back it down is the big question. How can we back it down in our marriages and start discussing behaviors rather than taking things personally and it becoming character issues? So this is a phrase that you need to learn how to say right here. Super practical. I don't like blank. I don't like blank. I don't like it when you don't do the dishes. That's different than this house is a wreck. That there's two different things there. I don't like fill in the blank. And make it about you. You don't like that the dishes aren't done. It may not bother your spouse that the dishes aren't done. When I grew up, when laundry got done, like, you folded it while it was hot. When the dryer stopped, you were standing there with an iron, ready to whip out those shirts and iron them. You didn't put anything in your closet that wasn't ironed. When I went away to college, I did not fold clothes for 4 years. Just out of pure rebellion. That was my college rebellion right there. Pulling socks out of a laundry basket. I've always been wild. It may not bother your spouse. They may not know it bothers you. And if we can learn to communicate, I have a problem with this behavior, not a problem with you, then there's a big, big difference in how those conversations seem to go. The second one is contempt. Now, contempt is a sense of superiority over your partner. And it's fueled. I'm going to tell you, contempt is something that goes, it goes on a little slow simmer. And it just gets hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter until it's in a full boil. And then it's going to be explosive. And here's what you have to learn about communication. You can have some uncomfortable conversations along the way, or you can have a nuclear bomb one day. So you can have some tense moments and learn how to navigate that, or you can have really big fights. I personally don't think fighting is productive. I don't know that I think it's even necessarily Christian to just get into these mean fights, like throwing things and all that. I'll let Brother Sutton handle the particulars of whether he's pro fight or non-pro fight. I just am not a pro fighter, but the thing is you got to learn how to not do that. And if you like fighting, you just need to realize you like fighting and that you're doing something you enjoy. I told a couple one time in church, I'm not going to keep talking to you because you enjoy what you're doing. When you get tired of doing it, come back and see me. But until then, right now, this is just sport. And it was. Like, they enjoyed it. There was nothing they liked more than a good fight. Like, it was fun. And if you like it, that's completely different. It's a whole different thing. I don't think many people like it, though. And so how do we avoid it? Because, and I'm not talking about avoiding conflict, and I'm not talking about avoiding difficult conversations. I'm all about having difficult conversations. But I am talking about how do we keep contempt. The more unresolved issues that we have between us as a couple, the more likely there is for contempt to get into our communication. So the more things that exist between us that we never resolve, the more likely we are to start getting condescending in the way we talk to each other, snarky in the way that we talk to each other. The Bible says, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. James said, can bitter water and pure water, it's James 3:9. I know where it's at. I just read it in four different translations yesterday. I can't remember the word for it. But it's, can non-salted water and salt water come out of the same well? And the answer is no. And what that means for us as married couples is you can't go to church and use your tongue to praise God and go home and use that same tongue to tear down your spouse. Because sweet water, pure water, and bitter water can't flow out of the same well. And that's tough, and it's tight, but it's scriptural. James 3, 1 through 12 are the most powerful verses about the tongue and about the power it has. It says the tongue is a small member, but it can light a fire. In Australia in 1990, one match burned 600 miles of land and killed all of the wildlife in 600 mile radius. One match did that. And James said the tongue is just like that. And you know where he said the fire starts? He said when the tongue gets going, and it's in every translation. You can read a bunch of translations. He said the fire is fueled by hell. And so contempt comes from nowhere good. And it'll set your house on fire. And again, it's tough and it's difficult, but it's as apostolics, I'm just going to tell you, it doesn't work to go to church and just sing high praises and just, oh, God is great, God is awesome, and shut up. It doesn't work because you can't get pure water and salt water. You can't get fresh water. Fresh is the word I have been looking for. You can't get fresh water and salt water out of the same well. And so it's super important how we learn to talk to each other. Because who's our first family? The church. We're part of the church. And if we're all part of the same body, we've got to talk the same way. You can't talk two different ways. Because you're part of a body. It's a unified being. And we learn to talk a specific way. I can tell you this. This is hard for me. My wife and I were talking about it on the way over here. Our family, and I'm not just bashing my family. There's a lot of good that came out of my family. A lot of rough stuff that came out of my family. But my family, if there was a competition for people that can cut you to the bone with their tongues, my family would at least be in the top three. And my wife is nodding without me even asking her opinion. It's just this automatic response. Yes, they can do that. My big thing, you come at me, it takes me like 20 seconds to get to the point where I'm going to go for like anything I know about you that can hurt you, I'm there. So I had to learn, you know, that's not going to, you don't make it 21 years in marriage doing that. I had to learn to talk differently. I had to learn that above all things, my wife is not out to get me. When we can get that straight in our head, you know what? I've hurt her feelings and she's hurt mine, but I don't know that either one of us have ever intentionally set out to hurt one another's feelings. And getting that understanding, it's called, if you read Brene Brown's stuff, it's the hypothesis of generosity. It's what is the most generous attitude I can assume toward what's going on right now. So she hurts my feelings. They may really, really be hurt, but what's the most generous way I can look at this? The day we got an understanding that we weren't intentionally trying to hurt each other was a good day later. And we had a conversation about it. You remember? Please say yes. I know she remembers. We had a specific conversation about, wow, we're hurt, but we didn't mean to. I did hurt you, but I didn't do it on purpose. That's a big, big thing to realize, that we're on the same team. Do I hurt you? Do I hurt people's feelings sometimes? Yeah, I do, because I'm broken and I'm human. Look at the person next to you, the one you came with. Some of you aren't cooperating. Look at who you're married to. They're going to hurt you, and you're going to hurt them. But I want you to tell each other, I don't mean to. Come on, say it like you mean it. Kind of like flutter your eyes and say, I don't mean to. That is a huge, huge thing. I can't stress this enough. Understanding, yes, I'm gonna get hurt. I'm going to hurt. But I don't mean to. This is a really cool thing right here. Couples that are contemptuous of each other tend to have more sickness, such as colds and flu, than couples who do not have contempt in their marriage. So essentially, good communication is the new NyQuil. It'll just cure all of your cold and flu symptoms. won't cure all of them, but it'll go a long way. How we can keep this out of our marriage is important. If you've got something that's simmering, have a conversation about it. If you've got something that's just sitting there, it's the elephant in the room, have a conversation about it. You both know it's there. Let's talk about it. It's not easy, but let's do it. The third thing, defensiveness. Defensiveness, it rarely results in the one who is complaining backing down and apologizing. Because defensiveness is our way of throwing things back to the other person and saying, this is not my problem. So if I use it, it's really a silly analogy and we never really did this. But like if she says you didn't remember what color my eyes were, and I say, but you can't remember my shirt size, that's defensiveness. That's me not taking responsibility for not knowing what color her eyes were. I have always known they were blue. Just kidding. See if you're paying attention. It's me lobbing it back at her. It's me completely ducking the fact that I didn't do something, didn't say something, I did say something, I didn't hold up my end of the bargain, and throwing it back, well, you don't do. Did any of us ever get defensive? I'm a defensive person. So part of it is I like a good debate. So like I'm always going to take kind of an opposing viewpoint, which is not always helpful if you're trying to communicate well in your marriage. I've found, save that for my friends that like that, and don't engage that with my wife. So defensiveness is any time that you throw something back, well, we've just become defensive. And more than likely, it's not going to resolve quickly or well when we're being defensive. The fourth thing that happens is a word that we use called stonewalling. And this is just where one of you just turns off and tunes the other one out. And so rather than confrontation, there's just disengagement, which just makes the one that is responsive even angrier. And so we just get this feedback loop. You're going to shut down, well, I'm going to yell louder. You're going to yell louder, well, I'm just going to look at my phone harder. You're going to look at your phone, then I'm going to scream louder and stomp my foot too. Well, then I'm just going to flip screens. And we get into this thing, that stonewall, and you can't have effective communication when somebody is shut down. And I am going to say that shutting down is its own way of fighting. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But these four things, until we're willing to acknowledge that they exist, criticism, contempt, defensiveness, and stonewalling, until we can identify where those things are in our marriage, we won't ever be able to communicate well. And again, communication does not necessarily mean more talking. It means talking about what needs to be talked about, even if it's really difficult. It's tough to do sometimes. Contempt and criticism, they can come across as like not having any immediate effect. But it does. Long term, these things build and build and build and build and build. And when we get into defensiveness and stonewalling, these things, when we get a constant flow of anything, there's a word that we like to use called your spouse is getting flooded. You criticize enough, you have enough contempt, you have enough defensiveness, you're going to flood your wife or your husband and they're going to shut down. We can only take so much. That's just the truth of any of us. And stonewalling is typically, in the beginning, it's a protective stance. It's a, I'm going to stop because I can't take anymore. Now, I do want to talk about this. If you choose to fight by shutting down, that is fighting. It's called being passive aggressive. Just because you're not saying anything doesn't mean you're not fighting. It takes two people to communicate, and if you won't participate, you're fighting. You're just fighting differently. Instead of throwing a punch, you've hired a lawyer. And instead of slapping, you've dumped water on somebody's computer. It's still aggression. It's just a different type of aggression. And it's just as deadly. And so it's not the high road. It's not the better way. It's just a different way. And it's really, really important if you are someone that does this, that you realize you're just as much a part of what's going on as the person who's being really aggressive in what they're doing. Now, I use this term. They taught us this analogy when I was getting my master's degree. I heard it so many times, I said I was never going to use it. And then, like, it just, people can get a visual image in their mind, so I use it all the time, and I just die a little on the inside every time I use it, but I'm going to. The only way to stop this whole dance of fighting and bad communication is somebody's got to quit dancing. Somebody's got to step out and say, we can't do this anymore. So if we're both screamers, somebody's got to quit screaming. If we have a pattern to how we fight, somebody's got to stop earlier in the pattern and say, you know what? We're headed toward an argument. We're working our way up to one of our good ones. And we have to stop the dance. The only way this is ever going to stop is somebody's going to have to stop it. You know what happens? I'm going to just warn you in advance. You know what happens when somebody quits dancing? It makes the other person really mad. Because they're standing out there by themselves. And you won't do anything with them. And so, it's not easy to begin with. And a lot of times we have to look back and say, hey, we did good for a few minutes, and then we kind of went back to the same thing. A lot of it's looking back and kind of debriefing over what just happened and figuring out how you catch it on the front end instead of the back end. So that's important to know. One thing else that I want to talk about, I think I'm getting really close, a couple things, and I'll be done for tonight. In communication, body language is important. How you use your body communicates really, really, really big. I always love to see when I have a new couple coming in, where they're going to sit and how they're going to sit. I had one couple I worked with. I always knew how it was going to go based on if she held her purse in her lap, I knew they were mad at each other when they got there. If the purse went on the floor and a pillow went between them, I knew it had been a bad week, but things were getting better. If the pillows and the purse went on the floor, I knew we've had a good week. And it was really that obvious. I've got two couples I work with right now. One of them, they come in, he sits here, she sits here, they stack all of the pillows in my office between them and turn away from each other. And they talk to me. They don't ever talk to each other. They look past each other to me and talk. It says a lot. I have another couple that's working through some really tough things. They sit right beside each other. And whenever they get ready to make the harshest statements, it's one of the coolest things. They always reach over and touch the other one, the husband or the wife, whoever's going to talk, touches the other one and looks at them dead in the eye and says in this tone of voice, some of the strongest things I've ever heard a couple say to each other. And the other one, it is amazing to watch because I'm watching this couple with all the pillows between them not be able to talk about where they're going to eat dinner without me having to referee and wave flags. And I'm watching this couple say things like, I'm really, really struggling not to resent everything about you at this phase of our marriage. And the other one saying, and I totally understand where you're getting that. That's a radical difference. But what they're doing with that body language, when you're touching someone and you're near somebody, that's a human being. That's not just an abstract thing. When you pull somebody close, they get really real when they're up in your space. And it's really hard to get as angry when we don't have the time to dehumanize. That was one of the powerful things, just to throw in that I saw Brene Brown today, so I can kind of die happy moment. One of the things she talked about, she lives in Houston, and she showed a picture of what it looked like and how high the water was. And she said, you know what happened here? She showed a picture of her husband with a kayak. She said, we picked up people, other people picked up people. She said, people were just getting people out of the water, and I never heard anybody say, who did you vote for? She said, because it's hard to hate up close. So when you get really angry, you know what you need to do? Pull in and get really close. Because it's really, really hard when you realize this is a flesh and blood person that has feelings. It's hard to be as angry. And we live in a really detached world of social media where we tweet things and we Instagram things. How many of you know when you've got friends that are a couple that you're friends with, and you know when they're fighting because they're those weird posts on Instagram or Facebook about when someone does you wrong and hurts you so badly, you just keep trusting in Jesus. That is a dehumanizing, passive-aggressive way of communicating. It's funny because we know a couple, they don't live in the same state as us, so don't try to figure out who they are. We always know when they're fighting because the wife's always going to post a picture on Facebook of the two of them and talk about what a great husband and dad he is. That's proof positive that if you call their house, it's going to be really frosty and cold. It's like, if I post it, I will believe it. Or I need to post this because the whole world can tell what's going on in our house. Stop communicating through all those avenues. Look at each other. Touch each other. And talk. Talk about tough things. Talk about hard things. Talk about hurtful things. And talk about it until you're finished talking about it. Don't leave it hanging out there. Talk about it until you figured out a plan. You may not be able to fix it right then, but talk about it until you get a plan of what you're going to do. Men and women are truly different. Fundamental brain function is really different. We go back to really, really core primal beings in that you go back to the age before technology, before all the conveniences that we have now. The female gender role was to nurse, to release oxytocin for a calming effect on her and her children. And men truly were hunter-gatherers, and their ability to be vigilant is what kept them alive. And so they had to be vigilant. That brain function still exists. I'm a brain science junkie. I read really boring biology books on neuroscience and things. That core brain function still exists. It takes men biologically longer to calm down than it does women. Men can stay madder longer. Men can keep score better. Because they're hunter-gatherers. Men get hypervigilant. Men have higher doses of cortisol and adrenaline released in their brain when they're fighting. It's a primal brain structure thing. We're different. Now, some of you may think, she can stay madder a lot longer than me. And sometimes that's true. I am talking in some stereotypes tonight, but typically, just the chemicals that are going on. I can tell you another powerful thing about touching. When we touch, everybody reach over and touch the person you're with. Not their clothes, their flesh. Touch their hand. Touch something where it's skin to skin. What just happened, it was a small amount, but oxytocin just got released. And oxytocin is the cuddle drug. Oxytocin is what is released when a mom is nursing a newborn baby. Oxytocin is the warm and fuzzy feeling. When we are touching someone, it makes it very difficult to get as hypervigilant and for cortisol to really overrule what's happening in the brain, because we're getting another drug released in our system, another chemical released in our system. And so physical touch is important. I'll tell you how important this is, and I'm almost done. I promise I'm going to let you go. Like, literally, we're about 3 to 5 minutes away. I have a client, was a veteran, did 3 tours of active combat, came home, life was a train wreck. I mean, just addiction, just out of control, lost his license for like 5 years. Parents had just really had their fill, and they said, okay, you've got 1 year that we're going to help you, and then we're done. And if you end up homeless, you end up homeless, but like, we're done. So he goes to college, signs up on a whim, not sober, signs up to become a massage therapist. Becomes a massage therapist, gets sober in the process of becoming a massage therapist, becomes a massage therapist, goes to work for a company, and incredibly intense PTSD survivor here. Like, huge PTSD symptoms. Goes to work as a massage therapist. So he's working five days a week, roughly, 8 to 10 hours a day, in a dim room with soft music playing, giving massages. Skin-to-skin contact releases oxytocin. So when he's doing the massage therapy stuff and getting skin-to-skin contact, guess what happened over the first year that he worked as a massage therapist? All of his PTSD symptoms went away. He quit having nightmares. He got completely sober off of all drugs and alcohol. He quit smoking. He quit getting triggered and having flashbacks. Now, I know not everyone can go become a massage therapist and do that. It's not what I'm advocating for. I'm just here to tell you, the power of physical touch is real from an empirically proven place. And if you'll engage in that with your communication, it will make your communications so much easier to have. Two quick things. Repair attempts, when you get ready to start trying to repair from a bad moment, here's the key. Be really nice. Everybody say, I. That is the best way you can start a sentence to repair. As Jeff and Sherry Easter call it, a bad, intense moment of fellowship. He said they don't fight. They have intense moments of fellowship. I was upset is different than you upset me. You made me mad is a different statement than I was really mad. So everybody say, I. Learn to start your sentences with I instead of you. I am upset. And then be nice in how you say I. Just because you're not starting a sentence with you, you don't need to go, I am upset because you. Because the focus is on I was upset. There's just some nice ways. I know it was today. I'm going to own the fact that it was today so that I don't seem like a forgetful husband. So when my wife asked what time it started tonight, and I said 8, and we had that conversation that it didn't just start on Friday, but it started on Friday at 8, she said, I'm about to ask you a question, and it's totally not antagonistic or smart aleck, but are there any other details that I need to know for this weekend? You know what? That was a really, really nice way of saying, we haven't communicated about the details, and I don't know anything that's going on other than we are going somewhere in Alabama. And can you tell me? It was a nice way to get that information rather than you never tell me anything. See how that works differently? So we can sometimes say that, especially if we're known, and she's not. I'm the one that has learned to say, I'm really not saying this in a mean way, because I can say something nice. I tend to get passionate about everything. Like, I can get passionate about whether we should leave this road here or not. Is that the truth? Like, there, in my life, every hill is a hill to die on. Every hill. And I can get really into it and come across super aggressively. And so I've had to learn to say, I really, really, really do not mean this mean. Because I can say something and truly not mean it mean, but if I'm in a hurry or it's an intense moment, it's going to come out really sharp. When I'm in a hurry, and if I'm stressed, and I've been in grad school for 6 years, so I'm stressed like all the time, I just beat and bang around. I just slam things and grab things and shove things in my backpack, and I am constantly running late. And I'm just... That's me, like every morning. And so one morning we'd got up and we were getting ready to start the day, and I don't even remember what we talked about. It didn't even matter. But I was doing my beating and banging around thing, and my wife was getting dressed in the closet, and she said, hey, are you upset with me or are you just stressed? I said, I'm just stressed. And she said, okay, just wondering. And went on and got dressed, and we went about our day, and everything was fine. Do you know what? That's really weird communication, but you know what didn't happen? She didn't personalize my beating and banging around. She didn't go through the whole day wondering what she did to make me mad. I didn't come home to her having created a scenario in her mind of what she needed to tell me because I'd been so rude when I left. All because one of us took the chance to step out and ask a really awkward, weird question. Are you stressed or are you frustrated with me? Super practical. It's not like they tell us in any of the books. That's the thing I figured out. Good communication, there's not a good book on it. We don't have to do this much anymore. This is truly how I'm a slow processor. Okay? You can't throw a bunch of questions at me. My wife is a pretty fast processor in that you can rapid fire a bunch of things and she can give you a lot of information. She can read really quickly. She retains a lot. I read really, really slowly, and I have to highlight everything and make notes. You can't ask me anything and expect an answer right then. If you ask me if I'm going to my room after we finish tonight, I'm going to say, most likely. So, true story. This is how pathetic it was. We had this agreement that she could email me all of her questions, and I had 48 hours to respond. Because you know what was happening? She was asking me questions. After, like, the second question, I would get totally overwhelmed. And I would just shut down. And my response was, I'll think about it. I'll let you know. And I would get really involved with my computer and just type harder and harder and harder until she got the message to quit talking to me. And then I would never give her answers. And then we would get right up to the event or the moment or what we needed the answer for, and it would be a lot of frustration. And we had to create the 48-hour thing because if she just asked me, I just wouldn't come back. I would forget. It would truly be an accident. I just wouldn't remember to come back and give the answer. Or I would tell someone else. This is what I'm the king of, I would tell Brother Sutton what we were going to do. And I would think, well, I've told someone, surely it was my wife. She heard an evangelist one night announce something we were going to do and how excited he was for our church. Because, and I thought I told her, not the evangelist. And so we have this running joke now. I'll say, I thought I told you that. And she'll say, no, you told Brother so-and-so. But that worked for us. Is that corny? Yeah, that's corny. But you know what? We don't. She gets answers and I don't get flooded. And so we don't argue. And you know what that makes? That makes for a really happy house. So you can think we're cheesy if you want to, that we emailed questions, but you know what we didn't do? We didn't fight. So which is better? There's no wrong way to do good communication. If you need to email, I work with one couple, they leave responses to each other under the smoothie blender on the counter. One writes the question on the way out the door. The other one writes the answer on the way out the door because the person that asked the question gets home first and they read the answer, and it resolves all the conflict by writing on these post-it notes and putting it under the smoothie blender. That's not in a book. Whatever works for you, just do it. It doesn't have to work for anyone else. No one else has to do it. Just find a good way to get rid of the criticism, the contempt, the defensiveness, and the stonewalling, and to talk, and to be nice, and realize it's a human that you like and that you're friends with. And we'll have really, really good marriages when we do these things. All right. Any questions before we wrap up? I give it back to Brother Sutton. Yes.
So, one thing that really this is a question about the communication part. I mean, the 48-hour rule, which I find very, very interesting. I'm the type of person where if I have a question about something or just something I want to get resolved, then I'd rather just get it over with.
For us, 48 hours was better than never, which is where we were at when we started the 48 hours. Again, it's what works for us. I can't give an answer. I cannot process with you. It's just a real deal. We had this thing a few months, it's probably been a couple years ago. We were at church. We live in the same house. Okay, we're married. We have two children together. I was leaving the church and driving to our house in my car, and she said, "Can the kids ride with you?" It was like a deer in the headlight moment. And she saw it and she said, "Oh, never mind." That's not a hard question. They're my children. They live in our house too. That's a really simple answer. I cannot give you an answer that quickly. It's a personality quirk. Yeah, pretty much. That would be, I would be that father. That would definitely be me. I took my youngest, or one of my children, shopping the other day. And I never got a name out. And I said, "Whichever child you are, come here." And we only have two. So their names are Georgia and Eden. And I just have learned to call them Jordan because it kind of mashes the names together. They just both answer to it. But again, if that wouldn't work for you, don't do that. That just works for us. So don't do that. What would work?
What would work? I'd rather just cash it out right then.
Would you? All right.
Because he has to wait on me to figure things out. He just has to do the hour. So, unfortunately, he gets one of those stonewall situations.
Ah. Exactly. Use the right word. That's it. It really is whatever works. If you have one person that processes fast and one that processes slowly, which is very, very, very typical in most couples, is that people process differently. You've got to figure that out. Like, what works? And sometimes it's going to hurt a little. You're going to have to wait more than an hour. But we got to figure out what does work. Because if you can process in 24 hours, it doesn't need to be 36 hours. Or 48 hours, or 72 hours, or 3 weeks. And so that's the goal, is to figure out what is working. I had to figure out, okay, over a 2-day span, I come up with answers to pretty much. Here's another thing. My wife can ask me a lot of questions. So it wasn't like she was asking me one or two questions. Also, need to throw in, she was asking me on a Sunday night. And a Sunday night is like, I'm really, really tired. I don't care if the world burns down. Much less where we're going to eat Thanksgiving dinner. By Tuesday, I care. Like, it becomes very important. But it doesn't on a Sunday night. Also, I am like in grad school. I teach, I pastor, and I'm a therapist. She doesn't see me a lot. So in all fairness, she's got to talk to me when she can. And so when she's got me cornered, it's like, okay, I've been saving this up for 4 days. Here are 50 things I need to know about. And she needs to know about it as a wife, a mother, a pastor's wife, all kinds of things. So all of those dynamics, whatever works into your relationship, all of those dynamics are real. The other thing, I'm a high-intensity person. Like, I'm typically not going to say yes. I'm going to say yes. Or I'm just going to be really indifferent. There's going to be a depth to what I feel. My wife's family, they're more low-intensity. And so I can say yes. And in my mind, if we're on a scale of 1 to 10, the intensity level feels like a 2 to me. And to her, it feels like an 8. So I think I just gave her a yes. Like, yes, I want to do that. She thinks I've just bit her head off. And she really, really does. And we had to figure out. My intense yes is not snapping all the time. Am I hearing what you're saying? Because what was happening is I was saying yes at a two. She was like, oh my word, he's angry. And so she'd be like, well, fine. And I'm like, oh my word, are we in a fight? I didn't know this. And so I would come back really at an eight, which is really intense. And so once we figured out, are you mad or are you just stressed? That was a big deal. Because it took out all of that responding at the level we assumed the other person was at. Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Or if you are scared to ask it in public, you can write it and let me know, and I'll give it to Pastor Sutton. I'll give it back to you.
How informative. So, if you have questions, you want to write them on the back of a $20 bill. And we'll explore those. Appreciate the good word, Brother Mills. And we're all taking notes. This is a good group. They're great students. And you're helping us. You're building us. We want to learn better dynamics for resolving and for building stronger relationships, better communication. I appreciate you guys coming and spending time with us, you know. Now, tonight afterwards, I know you have a lot of email to do. So, oh, you already took care of it. Okay. So, tomorrow morning, breakfast will be here at 8:30, and then at 9, we'll start our session. So, games and all, I don't know, do people bring board games to these things? They used to. Some people do. But, we just want to let Brother Sister Mills know how much we appreciate them being here. And tomorrow morning we'll gather again and have good instruction and good breakfast and good fellowship. So God bless you. Let's find some likely person here. Brother Ryder. By the way, when you cross that threshold and it gets that personal, you didn't realize that was $75 an hour, and you just wandered into. Well, why don't you pray for us tonight? And everybody said amen. God bless you.
As we have also forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.